Yeah. officius respice, atque protegendum nos dexterantue maestatis extende, per nominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivere regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
turbe multe, et ecce leprosus veniens adorabat eum, dicens, nomine civis potas me undare. Et extendens Iesus manum petitit eum dicens, volo mundare. Et quod bestim mundata est, lepra eius, in ait ii Iesus, vide nemini dexiris, sed vade ostende te sacerdoti, et oper munus quod precipit voices in testimonium iris. Cum autam introviset Capernaum, accessirat eum centurio, rogans eum et dicens, Domine, puer meus iacer in domo paralyticus, et male torquetur. Et ait ili Iesus, ego veniam et curabo eum. Et respondens centurio caeris, Domine, non sum dignus ut in pres sub tectum meum, sed tantum dic verbo esse habitur puer meus. Named ego homo sum sub potestate constitutus, habens sub me militas, et dico huic, vade et vadit, et ali venit et venit, et servo meo paco et facit. Audiens autem Iesus miraculis est, et sequentibus se dixit. Amen, dico vobis, non inveni tantam fidem in Israel. Dico autem vobis, quod multi ab oriente et occidente venient, et recumbent tum Abraham et Isaac et Jacob in regno celorum. Fidi autem regni aegientur in tenebras exteriores. Ibi erit pletus et stridor densium. Et dixit Iesus centuriori, Vade, et sicut pedisti fiat tibi, et sanatus est puer in illa hora.
Thank you. Paul's letter to the Romans. Brethren, be not wise in your own conceits, no man rendering evil for evil, providing good things not only in the sight of God, but also in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as is in you, have peace with all men. Revenge not yourselves, my dearly beloved, but give place unto wrath. For it is written, revenge is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. But if thy enemy be hungry, give him to eat. If he thirst, give him to drink. For in doing this thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head. Be not overcome by evil, but overcome evil by good. Please rise. Continuation of the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At that time when Jesus was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, a leper came and adored him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, stretching forth his hand, touched him, saying, I will it, be thou made clean. And forthwith his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, See, tell thou no man, but go, show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift which Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. And when he had entered into Capernaum, there came to him a centurion beseeching him, and saying, Lord, my servant lies at home sick of the palsy, and is grievously tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. And the centurion, making answer, said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant shall be healed. For I also am a man subject to authority, having under me soldiers. And I say to this one, Go, and he goeth, and to another, Come, and he cometh. To my servant, Do this, and he does it. And Jesus, hearing this, marveled, and said to them that followed him, Amen, I say to you, I have not found so great faith in Israel. And I say to you that many shall come from the east and the west, and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into the exterior darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said to the centurion, Go, and as thou hast believed, so be it done to thee. And the servant was healed at the same hour. Everyone this morning. A few announcements of the Mass schedule for the week is as usual. So daily Mass is Monday through Friday, 8 and 11:15. On Saturday, 8 and 9:30. And then there's Adoration Friday evening from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. We also welcome the Timberwolves who have survived their winter camp, so it's good to see you all made it through. And then also we say thanks to the Scola, which is made up of explorers and wayfarers making their debut of sorts today. So we're trying to get some new blood into the Scola, and they have been working hard. I've sung on a couple occasions for the Epiphany, but this is the first time that they're singing at a Sunday Mass, all of the propers and other parts, and also with the organist is also a wayfarer. So we're very proud of all of them, of coming up to the ranks and then are lending their talents to the liturgy today. Beloved in Christ, today we mark the third Sunday after Epiphany. The epistle for the Mass is taken from Romans chapter 12 and is a continuation of the reading from last Sunday. Today St. Paul says many notable things to us. We are not to return evil for evil. That as far as possible we are to have peace with all men. That we are not to revenge ourselves but leave that to God. And that we are to provide the necessities of life to our enemies. These brief but demanding admonitions should make us think. Since most of us are accustomed to living life, in the words of the psalmist, in the midst of our enemies. Both in society and the church, evil is done to us, and it is tempting to respond with evil, or to seek vengeance, or to avoid our opponents in the culture wars. In his commentary on why Jesus ate and drank with publicans and sinners, St. Thomas has some helpful things to say to us today. It is somewhat like Paul's adage that we should give food and drink to our enemies, for he does assume, I think, that we invite them to dinner, not that we leave it on the doorstep and let them eat as they wish. St. Thomas says there are three reasons why men avoid the company of sinners, that is, unrepentant sinners. First of all, out of pride and contempt, as the Pharisees did. A man of this sort thinks himself above the glutton or the impure man, the wrathful or the slothful. He is disgusted by his neighbor and disdains to associate with him or put up with his weakness. Another reason why men avoid sinners is for the benefit of the sinners themselves, so that somehow through social pressure they may be ashamed and converted. This is an attempt to wake up the sinner and get him to change his ways by ostracizing him. The final reason why men avoid sinners is out of care for themselves, fearing lest one be corrupted by the evil habits of the other. It should be evident that the first reason for avoiding sinners out of pride and contempt is not justified in any case. How can we disdain the sinner when our Lord came among us and died for us while we were yet sinners? We should say with St. Paul, "By the grace of God, I am what I am. And therefore, I cannot look down upon a man who is in need of the grace of God, just as I once was and still am in need of that grace." The second and third reasons for avoiding sinners, however, are open to us, and many of you already act with these in mind in some regard, especially as family and friends who live immoral lives. For some sinners, the deliberate avoidance of social interaction on the part of their family and friends is jarring enough to get them to question their lives and change. This seems to be less effective in today's pluralistic world than it was in past ages, but we can still rightly apply it to those whom we love where there's hope of it being effective for their conversion. On the other hand, the choice can also be made to avoid sinners to avoid the corruption of one's own moral life. And this also applies to those under our care, especially those of tender age. A common device of moral relativists is to present all moral choices and lifestyles as being neutral or normal, so that children grow up thinking that no actions are good or bad in themselves. So a child can be corrupted not only by imitating evil actions, which oftentimes they don't pick up on, but more fundamentally by having the mind corrupted, so that in formative years it fails to distinguish between truth and falsity, between good and bad. And this is why many parents choose to avoid any contact with sinners or greatly limit it and place it under certain restrictions. Of course, as I speak about sinners, I mean in the sense of those who are unrepentant, those who persevere in sin and do not wish to repent, and often go so far as to justify their actions, even publicly. All of us are sinners, and that we sin many times a day, as the proverb says. And many of us also have habits of sin that remain an issue despite our attempts to overcome them. But the repentant sinner strives to change his life so that he lessens or eliminates the occasions of sin and asks for grace from God every day and frequents the sacraments. Aquinas goes on to say that there are two reasons why some men abide with sinners, that is, dwell with them instead of avoiding them. The first reason is to test themselves, to grow in holiness by resisting temptation even though it is all around them. The example that he gives is Lot, who was daily vexed by the unjust deeds of his neighbors, and yet was judged just by God because he labored to be good amid these difficult conditions. Had Lot lived with only just men, then his holiness would have been in question, more of a matter of circumstance than actual striving. We should consider this, especially in places like the workplace, where we cannot avoid those who are unrepentant sinners. Oftentimes, the Lord allows this so we will grow in virtue, whereas if we were only with just men, we would only be complacent about those things. The second reason why men live with sinners is for the sake of their conversion. And this is why our Lord lived with them and was known for associating with them. As he knew there was hope for their turning away from sin and unto God, he spent time with them because most of us need social support if we're going to live saintly lives. And because our Lord was strong and there was no threat of his being corrupted, he could eat and drink with sinners without any fear. Concerning this, St. Thomas points out that in discerning whether one should spend time with sinners in hope of their conversion, it should be considered whether that man is weak or is strong. If he is weak, that is, he is prone to falling back into sin due to the bad habits of those around him, then he should not associate with them, even with the objective of bringing about their conversion, because not only will he not do that, but he himself will fall back into habits of sin. However, if a man is strong, that is, well established in virtue, then he should reach out to those sinners whom he thinks he can win for God. And that is why priests in particular are called to be strong in virtue, so they can reach out to all without exception. From all that I've said, it can be seen that motives matter, and that the same exterior action, whether it is avoiding sinners or frequenting with them, can have very different intentions behind it. That is why it is so unjust for activists to say that avoidance of unrepentant sinners is most certainly not what Jesus would do. None of us, in fact, is Jesus, who was divine and sinless, and therefore was able to associate with all men without difficulty. Each of us, however, must live according to our strengths and weaknesses, and pray all the while for an increase in charity, so that we can love more courageously and dangerously, so to speak, if we are called to that. As St. Paul says, we are not to be conquered by evil, but to conquer evil by good. All of us is called to that. But what that good means and what good we use to conquer evil is going to be different for each one of us based on our circumstances. The final point about all this is that we associate with sinners not only by having meals with them and engaging with them socially, but also exposing our minds and hearts to evil news. Our soul is the house of God, and if we allow other guests to be there who undermine the presence of God, we have to reevaluate our taking in of our information. To use the analogy of a man who is weak and therefore should not associate with sinners, most of us, if we are honest, are weak in regards to learning about the words and deeds of sinners. We take them in through reading too much or reading carelessly, and then instead of growing in virtue in response, we grow in anger, or acedia, or sadness. And those things can then lead to further sins like gluttony, lust, and sloth. We should learn not to invite these kinds of guests to our table and leave them outside. It's far different than the sinners we meet day to day. The ones we encounter online are not real people, so to speak. So if your reading of the news leads to doing what Our Lady of Fatima said to do, and you fast and pray and make sacrifices for the sinners that you read about, especially those higher up, then continue to read the news, because it shows that you are strong. But if it leads you into sin and undermines your spiritual life, then don't read the news if you can avoid it, because you are weak. Sometimes the most effective way to conquer evil by good is to not let evil come near us, especially into our minds and hearts, lest it hamper our doing of the good. And how much good is left undone in today's world because we allow ourselves to be disturbed interiorly without good reason? It is likely that in the coming months, each of us is going to be vexed a great deal. So let us remember what St. Paul says to us today. Noli vincia malo, se vince in bono malo. Do not be conquered by evil, but conquer evil in good. If we let our enemies get to us and throw us off from doing good, then they have won. But if we take the evil that's thrown at us and turn it into tears, and to prayer, and to fasting, then we have won. Let us draw strength today and all the days that we can from the blessed body and blood of our Lord, and then fight manfully day by day, until we reach that place where battles will end and evil will be no more, and that world to come that Christ has prepared for us in the New Jerusalem.
Oh, Thank you. Lord, is there ever
Domine, agiris subtilis terra.